Afternoon, everybody. I've stolen balanced research. I think I was a balanced scientist, but I didn't like that. So I've just stolen researcher. Those who were at the very first camp at Wee Jasper, I put this on my first slide to say, hi, I'm Peter. They did the talks on about the third or fourth day. We'd been drinking for 2 days. Everybody knew me. But hello to everybody that I don't know. Being a feral scientist, before you open your mouth, Tony, that's because I work on feral animals. It's not me, it's the animals. They're feral. This was my PhD project. People gave me lots of advice when I first started, mostly my bosses at work who had done their PhDs 10, 20 years ago. They said, make it your life. Your PhD has to become your life. You're young, you're energetic, you're enthusiastic. Stay that way. Make it your life. Make it your priority. Don't get married. 2 years in to my PhD. Okay, whatever you do, don't have kids. They take up all your time. 4 years in to my PhD. Look at the hair. I don't know if it was the PhD or the kids, but something's changed. But I've got a wonderful family, and this is one of the best things that has happened since my PhD, so I love my family. One of the other things that I've learned very early on with my PhD project, don't name your thesis a question, because at the end of it, that's your thesis. There's supposed to be like 100 pages in a thesis. Mine was, yes. So I changed the title, because as we all know, working with animals, it's never that simple, because the answer is yes, kind of, sort of, some places, doesn't matter. So a quick rundown of my results. Oh, got rabbits from all over the eastern half of Australia, took them back to Inglewood, that's marked on there, that we had a field research station there, challenged all these rabbits with rabbit calici virus, saw how many we could kill, how many we didn't kill, the idea being that if we couldn't kill them all, then they were probably resistant. Got to go out and work in the desert and in the rainforests and all sorts of places. It was fantastic. Got this range of percent infection after challenging the rabbits with calici virus. The ones on the left-hand side aren't resistant. They all died. As you go along, there are increasing levels of resistance. So that's a nice result, but a graph like that doesn't tell you much. So we tried to work out why there might be different levels of infection, mortality, survival, different levels of genetic resistance coming in. So we mapped it against rainfall. That's a common thing you do. And we've got this lovely curve, which is a classic example of correlation, not causation, because rainfall hasn't got anything to do with viruses killing rabbits. Not really. You don't see viruses going, no, it's too wet here, I'm going to stay inside. So then try and find reasons. On that left-hand edge, it's dry. Rabbits struggle to survive. Actually surviving and reproducing in arid areas is more difficult than being affected by viruses. So there's not actually much opportunity for an accumulation of resistant alleles, because even if they do get an epizootic outbreak and there are only survivors left that are resistant, they're going to die from the drought anyway. So you don't get this accumulation of resistance. On the right-hand edge, where there's lots of rainfall, we found this other calici virus that doesn't kill rabbits, it just protects them against the lethal ones, so it's more prevalent in those areas. And so, again, there's not the opportunity for rabbits to build up genetic resistance because they're being vaccinated effectively by this non-pathogenic calici virus. That's where some of the populations for Bacchus marshes in central Victoria had the highest amount of resistance. Bulli Downs was the most arid area that we had, and Yambuck in South Australia. Then we wanted to see whether this actually does mean that rabbits are becoming resistant, so the virus is useless. So we challenged some domestic rabbits, killed as many of them as we could with the virus. The ones that survived and didn't produce antibodies have some resistance to it, and we tested them against field strains of the virus to see what the virus was actually doing in the field. We tested from site at Turret Field in South Australia, just outside Adelaide, where they'd been doing work there for many years on rabbits and viruses since Khaleesi virus was first introduced in the mid-90s. In 2006, there wasn't an outbreak. They get an outbreak every year in about September, October. And in 2006, the outbreak wasn't as big as they were expecting, and that's what sort of kicked off the whole thought process that genetic resistance might be happening. 2007 and 2008, back to normal. Exactly the same number of kills. When we tested this against their domestic rabbits, we saw exactly the same thing. The Czech strain is what you get in the bottle. It didn't kill the rabbits very well. The 2006 strain that we got from the field did okay, but didn't kill all the rabbits like it should have. 2007, 2009 strains both did. And even more impressively, they killed them fast, faster than we had ever seen. One of the earlier slides that was presented today said Khaleesi virus kills rabbits in 48 to 72 hours. That's generally right. With this 2007 and 2009, it was within 40 to 45 hours. It was very fast. And it also produced a high level of genomic copies in the rabbits. So it not only killed more, it killed them faster, but it also made a lot of viral particles that could then be passed on. So out in the field, the virus was actually changing to be better at killing faster, quicker, but still transmit very well. So the outcomes of my PhD research, yes, rabbits are getting resistant to the original release strain. That resistance is genetically based. We tested that by testing subsequent generations, but didn't work in all areas quite so well. And the virus is not attenuating like most viruses do. It's, if anything, becoming a bit more virulent. And those field strains are replicating faster, and killing more rabbits. So coming back to the Balanced Researcher Program, talking about how good you can blame Tony for this one again. If Tony comes up to you and says, can I just get a photo? Don't run, because we'll get a photo of you running, but just say no. Thank you. But after, well, my PhD took about 5 years to do, I became a very balanced researcher. I learned a lot of skills, and those skills helped me going forward after that project. So a few people have been putting up how many different jobs they've had and how they've moved all around the place. When I started my PhD, I was actually employed by Queensland Government, the Department of Natural Resources, as an experimentalist. I went through all these different jobs, different departments. If you notice the years, though, it's about every 3 years. That's when we have elections in Queensland. You get a change of government, you get a new department, you get a new job title. So I've done all of that, but I've sat in the same chair. I've actually sat in three chairs because the government's very generous. They're all comfy. Effectively doing the same work. But what the Balanced Researcher Program allowed me to do was to develop skills that allowed me to then convince my supervisors, my managers, that I could do more than just be a technical officer going out there swinging spotlights, checking traps. And I've been given the opportunity to actually lead projects as a part of this. So I finished my PhD. In theory, I'm an expert on rabbit biocontrol and virology. I've got a couple of publications out of my PhD on that exact topic. We did some work on the non-pathogenic Khaleesi virus as well with Tanya Stryver's group at CSIRO. Went too fast there. There's one on rabbits, but it's about how much they like eating veggies. It doesn't have anything to do with viruses. They like eating veggies. That's what we learned from that one. But only when they're seedling, it only matters when they're seedlings. If you get lettuce as a seedling or broccoli as a seedling, the rabbits will devastate. If it's half grown, it won't actually impact the yield of the crop at all. They can eat as much as they like and it doesn't impact the crop. Again, rabbits, but again, not viruses. This is how well they breed in hot conditions up in tropical North Queensland, because there's rabbits up there where they shouldn't be because it's too hot for them to breed, according to all the literature. They do that by relying on their fat stores. They don't have subsequent litters. They just burn through their fat and do all right. That was another virus one. Here's another virus one. Tony Cox did that one. So I then did a talk on reorganising the rabbit toolbox, where we did some looking at how much you actually need to use viruses, or if you can just do harbour control and that does the job for you. So after doing a whole PhD on biocontrol, you don't need it. you can just destroy their breeding harbour and that controls the rabbits. It's based on the fact that the biocontrols have done their job already and the rabbit numbers are so low that now you can just destroy where they breed and everybody's happy. That's not rabbits at all, that's cats. Got to start working on feral cats for a little bit. Coming up next, feral pigs. Did some work on feral pigs too. Non-impact, non-target impacts of feral pig baiting. There's another one back on rabbits again, but this time it's actually on Q fever and rabbits as vectors for Q fever. Back on rabbits again, but this isn't actually rabbits, it's dunnarts and lizards in arid Queensland. If you get rid of the rabbits, the dunnarts do well. It's great. And dogs, I've got to work on dogs and cluster fences in central Queensland too. So the Balanced Researcher Program gave me a whole range of skills that were translatable across species, even though I'm a rabbit expert, I can do all of these other things. On feral pigs again. So what I'm doing at the moment, I've just got to run through these quickly, a little bit more on feral pigs and fruit baiting. Ranging of unowned urban cats, even though they're feeding, they're actually unowned, but they've got radio tracking collars on them. They have very small home ranges compared to the thousands of hectares that we saw just before. These have about half a hectare. Wildlife impact of cluster fences, seeing how the impact of getting rid of dogs and having these fences helps out kangaroos mostly, but also lots of other native animals. And I am still working on rabbits. So how well rabbits actually breed once we've gotten rid of their good breeding harbour, how will they breed in like log piles, rocky outcrops, and how susceptible they are to predation. Because I'm a technical officer leading projects, I have to find my own technical staff. That's my eldest son, Lachlan, that was about 5 years ago. He looks happy. That's my youngest son helping me in the camera traps for the couple of weeks ago. Don't let the ferals win.